Welcome back to Palm Breeze Cafe. I'm Lee Keller.
I'm Kim Cavanaugh.
And Kim, do you remember when you were young?
No.
How much trouble? It was a while ago. Yeah, even longer for me. But your parents used to regulate how much time you had on the telephone.
Right.
Technology.
And where you would go,
yeah.
And who you would see, and what you would do. And I was thinking about that when I was a teenager. The thing was to go to the library, hop on your bike and go to the library. And, you know, I think probably I went by the library few times on the way to where I was really going, which was to hang out with other teenagers.
Yeah.
So, again, nothing new what our kids are doing. What's new are the vehicles that they use and the technologies
and
they use.
They don't even have to leave home to go somewhere.
They don't have to leave home. And parents can't, you know, if I know you're hanging out with Johnny and Johnny isn't the kind of person I want you to hang out with, I can take steps to change that.
Mm-hmm.
But you may not even know who Johnny is or that your child is even associating with somebody because they're doing it online, they're in a computer, and they're doing it with tools like this. And we have a screen here with some of the chat applications. Chat is very popular with
very
teenagers.
Popular. And this is almost like an evolution of things. AIM was probably the biggest
right.
chat function that came out, even though it wasn't the first one.
Right.
It's AOL's Instant Messenger.
America Online, right.
And... today, a lot of kids still use it extensively.
And sometimes they'll use multiples. They might have an AIM account. They might have an MSN Messenger account, a Yahoo account, and have different identities for each one of those.
And there's software that combines it. My youngest daughter uses a program called Trillion.
Right. We have that down there as cross-program. So
mm-hmm.
you can be in that program, and you can get messages from all sorts of different accounts.
All different accounts. Mm-hmm. Multiple accounts in each of these applications.
So is this bad? I mean, kids are communicating. They're socializing. They're keeping up with a network of friends. Is it a bad thing that they're chatting?
You know, it's like anything else. Like when we were growing up, it's not bad to make friends and have a lot of friends.
No, it's not.
But mom and dad have to understand who these friends are,
right.
be able to see some of those things. And in the next segment, I think we're going to talk a little bit about some of the things that mom and dad can do to record those conversations and
find out.
Happening.
And we'll talk about what kind of things that are, you know, appropriate. Every parent has to make their own choices about what they want to do. But it's
yeah.
important that parents know that their students or their children, if they have an internet connection, are more than likely involved in these kind of things.
Something you just about stumbled on there. Parents and our children versus students. Now, a lot of these things cannot be done
right.
in school.
No, they cannot. And most of the things that we're talking about, none of the chat applications will work in a school environment.
Mm-hmm.
None of the social networking tools will work in a school environment. We take steps to block those
mm-hmm.
Because they are not part of our educational mission.
So this is really
but
more
let's
of a
talk,
responsibility at home.
Well, it is, but let's talk about some shifts that are happening because educators all over the world are beginning to realize that one of the things that we might be responsible for as educators is teaching our students how to be responsible online,
yes.
how to manage their identity. In other words, how to be accountable for what you do. Even though you're in an environment where people don't really know you, if you start putting things online that brand you as a
yeah.
certain kind of person that
yeah.
you know that other people can find. Very interesting Doonesbury article this week, or Doonesbury cartoons this week.
You have time to read cartoons.
You can't miss Doonesbury. But the college-age girl is
yeah.
talking about her Facebook profile and asks her friend if this picture is one that I should have up on my Facebook profile. And her friend says, no way. Because, you know, it gives the wrong idea.
Yeah.
And so, you know, as educators, we're beginning to talk about these kind of things. How do we teach our students to be responsible with their social network, responsible young adults, and help them become better citizens in what has become not only a regular world, but a virtual world as well?
My kids are actually grown up now, and I remember having that conversation with one of my daughters about her screen name.
Mm-hmm.
Her screen name alone can portray something about you. And if you want to have something in there that looks really cool, okay,
right.
you're trying to look cool, so you've got something a little bit pushing the edge there.
Mm-hmm.
You're sending
mm-hmm.
the wrong message globally.
Mm-hmm. And did your parents talk to you when you were a teenager about how the friends that you hung out with
oh, yeah.
are a reflection on you as a person?
Yeah.
Nothing has really changed in that regard. And it's true in the social network. We have a map up here that I don't know, I've seen this twice this week in presentations where
it's very
I've
good.
Been. And it talks about this online community world where kids live today.
It's actually a good place for parents to study if they were to go at each of the places on this map. I mean, AOL's an easy one there, MySpace. But there are things there that parents may not even know about, like Zanga, all the blogs that are out there.
IRC, and all sorts of things that are really, again, part of the everyday life of our teenagers. And, you know, as we go on to the next slide, we'll talk a little bit about some of the things that, you know, that parents, again, might want to be aware of. And actually, I think we're gonna, that's the end of that show, so we're gonna cut away from that.
We didn't talk about that one slide much, the one with the social networking things on
it. All right, let's go back to that real
quick. Because there's a lot of things on there that go beyond what a lot of parents probably know about. Like MySpace, that's on the news.
Well, it's the number one. It's the number one, especially for certain ages. If you have a child who's in middle school and or a younger high school student, you can be pretty certain they have a MySpace page and a profile.
Just one?
With information about them. Yeah, they may have more than one.
They probably have
And so one. These are things that you need to talk to your children about. And if they have one, you need to see it. You need to look at their profile, you need to review it with them, and you need to talk to them about the rules that you establish as a parent on how they are to conduct themselves online. And that includes the photograph that they have up there.
That's a very important one.
Description of who they are. Should your child have their full name on on the internet?
Never your full name,
no.
Never your phone number, and never your address.
That's right. None of those things, and yet some kids don't stop to think. That these are this is private information that would allow someone to find you if they chose to
parents,
do it.
And real tough thing for parents, you could have the most open child in the world say, here's my MySpace page, okay? Look at this. Okay, that's one of them. It's not the one I use the most often.
I think it happened to somebody sitting at this desk who asked his daughter to make me a friend. The way it works is you have a list of friends. I actually created a MySpace profile for myself called Watchful Dad. Which I thought was
good.
A wonderful name, because when her friends would then be on her MySpace page, she would see that one of the friends was Watchful Dad. That worked for a couple weeks until she decided to create a new profile, which she thinks I don't know about. And that new profile doesn't include Watchful Dad as a friend. But, you know, I'll change that.
A little later we'll show parents how to find out these things.
And,
that's
you know,
the
again,
hard part.
Is it bad? No, it's not bad. These teenagers want to operate in a world that doesn't, it doesn't have adult intervention all the time, so they can be social and learn what it's like to be among their friends. So many changes happen between the ages of 12 and 18, and a lot of those are social.
Now, real quickly, some of these other ones, Facebook.
Facebook tends to be for older high school and college students.
Okay, Twitter.
Twitter is a very cool little application that allows people to basically send out instant messages to through the internet.
Yeah, blogs is very broad, but YouTube, another one we see all the time on television.
Used for both good and for some very bad behaviors as well. And
Second Life, we talked about that before. And World of Warcraft, you see that come up a lot, and it's got this ominous name to it, but it's really an online game that includes social networking.
It does, and people go online, and it's not just all about killing aliens or bad guys or those kind of things, but it's also part of, again, a virtual world that mostly young people have created in which they can operate and be social and visit with their friends.
Well, when we come back, we're going to be talking about some of the tools that parents can use to help fight this safety situation online. So we'll be right back on Palm Breeze Cafe.